Hello and welcome to the 66th. Damn it. Right out of the gate. Hey! Hello! Welcome to the 66th gathering of the Adventure Party on this, the 5th of February. I am your party leader, Brad Ludwig. We ask that you peace tie your swords, holster your blasters, and make sure your paints and brushes are in excellent shape while you are gathered at the meeting table. Yeah, paints and brushes. I've been having what we call at my place of employment, lunch of sadness. I've been eating at my desk in my office. And while I've been doing that, I've been watching some YouTube channels. I've really got the bug to paint miniatures again and you know, try my hand at building some terrain and stuff. And I wanted to kind of share some of the things that I've come across, some channels that I enjoy. One that I enjoy, but the narrator has a gimmick. I don't enjoy the gimmick, but the knowledge he imparts is very good. So I'm still going to give him a shout out, but I'm just letting you know that everything that I'm going to share with you, while worthwhile, there's one that it's worthwhile, but you kind of have to, at least I have to grip my teeth and push through. I'll let you know what that gimmick is. So on that note, we have the one, the only Glenn Bittner. He is a movie reviewer on his YouTube show, The B-Movie Bunker, and he is the creator of the RPG called Mistrunner. How are you?
I'm scared.
Scared?
Scared. Terrified. Finally.
You'll know. Sorry? More about I'm sorry, what?
I said you'll learn more in my review of why I'm so scared.
Oh, okay. Well, there's a hell of a teaser. We've got an interesting news article that you remember RuneScape, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, Amazon's bringing it back and making it kind of sexy. And what is my other? I had one other. Oh, hey. We've talked a lot on our shows about ways that you can contact us. We have a listener named Boto Winter who actually called in. Huh? Yeah, we have the call and we're going to play it in our feedback section. So, and we actually got a comment on one of our videos and we'll talk about that as well. So let's just jump right into it. And, I hope that you scare the crap out of us with your review of your game, Glenn. What game is going to scare the pants off of us?
10 Candles. This is a, role-playing experience from Calvary Games, brought to us by Stephen Dewey. It's a little blurb from the publisher itself is, 10 days ago, the sky betrayed you. The world went dark. The sun vanished. 5 days ago, they came. And now, they're coming for you. Keep moving. Don't lose hope. And stay in the light. So it's a tragic, tragic horror tabletop role-playing game. Based around cooperative storytelling. It is designed for a one-shot session. The reason being for that is that the players take on the roles of survivors in the middle of a sunless apocalypse, living out the last few hours of your character's lives. The game master controls them, which are the unseen adversaries who stalk just beyond the light's edge. But this isn't a story about monsters. It's a story about what happens in the dark, what happens to those who fight against it, seeking hope within it, and inevitably become consumed by it. This game, I just had to try it out, and oh, it is incredible. What makes it really interesting is the setup of the game itself. So in 10 Candles, what's required to play, you need your typical paper, index cards are best, obviously markers to write with. You need 10 dice of one, six-sided dice of one color as the player pool, and then one color die for each individual player as well, a different color for each player. You need a voice recorder, like what you'd have on a smartphone. Then you need a large bowl, which you can burn paper in, and 10 tea light candles. Thus, the name of the game being 10 candles. The candles work in that every time a scene changes, you extinguish a candle. If a candle is extinguished accidentally, the current scene ends immediately and you move on to the next scene. You're supposed to play this in a dark room with the only light being these 10 candles. So you have a game master and everyone else has characters. And the character creation, I'm going to cut out a lot of excess stuff because there's a lot going on in this game. But your character, you're made up of, you have two traits. You have a vice and a virtue. So you might be like, say, a coward who's honest or a brave and paranoid, something like that. And then you have a moment, which will be some defining thing of what will happen, of like when you will find hope. You know, I will find hope when, I hear my father's voice again, or, you know, when I find my missing sister. And then lastly, you have the break, which is, this is something that you are capable of when it's darkest. And this is generally written by another player. It's another player will write something horrible that they saw you do. They may have seen you beat your wife or run someone over and drive away, something like that. These note cards then are stacked in front of you. And as things change during the game, you will burn these cards. When all of your cards are burned, you are dead. When all the candles go out, anyone still left alive will die. The voice recorder is used so that each player at the start of the game will record basically the last thing, you know, if someone ever finds this, this is the last things that you would have said. So it's kind of like your last little bit of whatever happened to you. The game is fascinating. How a round or a scene starts is that you go around the table and you utter a simple sentence that is a basic truth. So for example, like the world is dark. We are alive. We're trapped on this space station or in this shopping mall. And you go around and you do a truth for every candle that's still lit, including the game master. Then you just kind of the game master will set up the scene, give you the base narrative, and then the players will take the story from there. And every time you have to do something that requires like conflict, you roll the dice. You roll that big pool of 10 dice. And when you roll the dice, all you need is one six out of all those dice to succeed. Any ones that you get are put aside. If you want to, you can burn one of your note cards, starting with your vices and virtues, then moving to your moment, and then finally your brink, and that'll let you re-roll the dice. And as the game progresses, as you move into scenes, you only get as many dice as there are candles still left. And as the dice are taken away, they shift to the game master. And he's rolling against you. So now, if you succeed in an event, you get to describe what happens. I succeeded, and this is the result. If you succeed in an event, but the game master rolls more sixes than you, you still succeed, but the game master describes what's happening. If you fail and you get no sixes, the game master tells you what bad thing happened. It's just such an interesting, it's so unique in the setup using the candles. And it really, really gets that feeling of dread across as the candles start to go out, or when someone bumps the table and knocks out two candles at once, as what happened in the game we played. So it's just really interesting. And you get this way of being very heroic, too, because of the fact that, you know, it's like, oh, man, this is really going to, you know, the party's in, you know, huge trouble here. They're breaking down the door, and you can burn that last note card of yours. Even though you know, I mean, at the start of the game, everyone's going to die. But it's the fact that you sacrifice yourself to give everyone else just that little bit extra time. It's just fascinating. And the game book comes with 25 setup scenarios, not like huge in-depth. It gives you the basic outline of a scenario. Plus, you can just make up your own. Just a really, really cool game. And there's so many things involved in it that just is really awesome.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, it's super cool.
I want this for my collection. And I'm getting Hello. Why am I getting feedback here? Hello. There we go. That was weird.
Okay.
I'll fix it in post. All right. Who makes this? This is absolutely fucking brilliant.
Yeah, Cavalry Games. And then I said the creator is Stephen Dewey.
Wow.
I don't think it's currently in distribution at all, but you can buy it direct from them. You can get the soft cover book for $28 or a PDF for $10 or get a combo of the two for $35.
Okay, I'm going to stop screen sharing here. Yeah. It got an Ennie Award. It was an Ennie Award nominee for Product of the Year, Best Game, Best Rules, and Best Electronic Book. Indie Groundbreaker Award and Indie RPG Award runner-up for Most Innovative Game. Golden Geek Award nominee for RPG of the Year. Wow. And yes, you can. Okay, you can get the soft cover for $28, the PDF for $10, or you can get the bundle of the soft cover and PDF for $35.
Yeah.
And you find that at calvarygames.com. That really, I want to stop doing this show right now and find a group of people and play this because that.
I want to come up to point and play this with you guys.
Absolutely. Oh my God. This would be something I would love to get Todd Roll in on and some of, and Rob Benton, Jess Benton. Yeah. And you, absolutely. Oh, this just sounds really intense. And it looks like it's designed to be one shots, obviously, because.
Because you all die.
At the end of the game, you're all dead.
Yeah.
And that's the deal. You know, there's something liberating knowing that that's the final bit of the game.
Yeah.
You're going to die. And now you get to play out how you live your last moments of your life. Do you be a selfish prick? Do you try to help the others stay alive as long as possible? How does it all work? And sitting in the dark and having it get darker and darker as the scenes change out, as the table gets bumped. As a stray breeze might blow out a candle or two. I could see that just getting really intense really quickly. And there is, I'm going to equate this to something. I can't remember the name of the game system now. Former guest and fantasy author Pat Rothfuss.
Are you thinking of Dread?
I think that's what it was.
The one that uses the Jenga tower.
No. This would have been. No, it wasn't Dread.
Okay.
I can't remember that. I remember hearing the story of. A group of our friends got together with Pat. They're hanging out. And everybody was kind of pestering Pat to run something. And he's like, all right, you fuckers, here we go. And he used this system. And I think, I remember some of the mechanics. You play yourself. Shoot, I can't remember the name of the system. Damn it. But basically, and I played this system. You.
Is it fairly new?
No. It is. Oh, okay. I played this in 99.
Oh, okay.
They played it in probably 94, 90, I'd say 95. And You play yourself. You write up your stats, and then actually, no. I take that back. Everybody makes your sheet for you.
Okay.
Because you cannot be objective about yourself. Okay.
Yeah.
So everybody creates by committee your sheet for you. And you leave the room. You get called back into the room and you go over your sheet, and then you can make the case of, okay, well, I see what you did here. I don't quite get that, whether it should be higher or lower. And you finalize the sheet. You go through that process until everybody's done. Everybody has their character sheets, and you play the game. And to this day, some of the folks will talk about seeing a white van. Pat had this thing where people were being abducted, and the common thread was there were white vans around town that would show up, and people would be abducted and thrown into these white vans. And the story that he told was so in depth and sucked people in so hard that for weeks after they played the game, everybody just got freaked out whenever they saw a white van in real life. It was that good, that intense, and I can see 10 Candles being that same, having the potential to have that same effect on people. So, yeah, this is an excellent review and a great recommendation, and I will be adding this to my collection.
I gotta go back and remember what that game was.
Yeah, I
popped my head. There was one like Dream Park, which was kind of along those lines. If only there was some place like, you know, where these things were archived, like in a network of some sort, we could go look at them. We'll have to go check that out.
Yeah, damn it. I would have to, I'll see Rob tomorrow night. I'll be able to ask him, and I'll try to follow up on the next show and give the name of that game system. But we played it. This is years after that and with a different group, but I ended up playing it in about 99, 2000. So it was a lot of fun. All right. So thank you for bringing 10 Candles to our attention.
Yes.
If you would like to have other awesome things brought to your attention, you can follow this podcast on Twitter. You could like our Facebook page or subscribe to our YouTube channel. Find us by searching for Galactic Netcasts at all the major social networks, or click on the icons at gncasts.com. Now, I teased this at the beginning. Have you heard of like the Amazon Echo, the Echo Dot? Basically, it's AI's kind of strong. But it's like Siri, but through Amazon, and you can use it to control things. You can order things through your Amazon account. You can ask it questions like, "Hey, you know, Alexa, what's the weather like?" Or depending on what you name it, you can either name it Amazon, Alexa, or Echo. That's completely up to you. And it can answer some questions for you. And what Amazon ended up doing is tagging this into basically a version of RuneScape. So here we go with the story. Amazon's voice-activated Echo isn't the first piece of hardware you might think of when it comes to gaming, but Jagex is looking to change how you see, or rather hear, the device. The Cambridge-based developer is best known for its MMO, RuneScape, and it's that fantasy world the team is turning to for its first Echo game. Available as a skill for all Alexa-equipped gadgets, One Piercing Note adapts an in-game quest for Amazon's audio assistant, turning it into an interactive spoken word murder mystery. The audio game abandons all physical controls, with players becoming the voice of an adventurer investigating a murder at a secluded abbey. This being RuneScape, though, the scene takes a turn for the demonic, with unholy secrets uncovered along the way. Now, this story comes to us from wired.co.uk. Now, we own two Amazon devices. Anessa is, I would describe as a technophile. We now have, she got a deal on an Xbox One. So we have a PlayStation 4, an Xbox 360, and an Xbox One. We have two Amazon Echoes. We have a Raspberry Pi that we haven't touched and done anything with yet, but I think we're going to put Retro Pi on it and make it into a gaming system with gaming emulators for name the system, Intellivision, ColecoVision, Atari, Sega Saturn, whatever.
Dantooine?
What's that?
I said Dantooine. That's a system, right?
That's where the rebel base is. Yes, you are right, but no, you are also wrong. So no points scored for you. Anyways, I'm actually going to try to convince Anessa to see if we can install this on Alexa and give this a go, because it just sounds like a lot of fun. And you kind of have a first you know, I kind of think of it, I'm going to show my age here, Zork, which was a text-based adventure that was on computers in the 80s.
Hello, Sailor.
Yeah. And but it was such a huge seller and a huge deal. It blew people's minds because you could use a computer to play an interesting game. And I see this kind of being somewhat like that, you know, basically not necessarily repurposing, but using a device for another purpose that is something you probably wouldn't have thought to do with it. So I'm going to see if we can give it a shot and report back and see how it goes and what it's like. So be listening for a future episode where I'll talk about what I find out about the game. And that's it's RuneScape, essentially by One Piercing Note for the Amazon Echo system. See, if you like what you've heard on this Galactic Network, oh my God, it's like my mouth doesn't work anymore. Say, if you like what you've heard on this Galactic Network podcast, please consider helping us out financially. Perhaps I can get vocal lessons or learn how to talk. By going to gncasts.com/support, you can on that page you'll find links to our Patreon campaign, where you can make a small recurring monthly pledge of as little as $1, or you can click on our Amazon affiliate link and make a purchase, and we get a very small percentage from that sale. Again, you can go to gncasts.com/support. The Kickstarter spotlight.
Dun, dun, dun.
Da, da, da. I'm sorry. Here we go. Let's get a little. Well, that sounds broken. I'm going to have to take that out in post. That was crap. I'm sorry. I'll never do that again. Say, last week we talked about Pathogen Unclassified. So, I brought that to the table, didn't I?
You did.
I did. So, it is my turn to report. All right. Pathogen Unclassified, a role-playing game, an apocalyptic survival RPG set 3 years after a global parasitic outbreak. You play survivors trying to find ways to stay alive. Now, their goal was to raise $2,000. As of today, as of now, they have raised $2,023. So they've made their goal. there's still 10 days to go. So they can potentially crack some Oh, they don't have stretch goals here. It's just the deal. Yeah. Nice. So it is stripped down. $7 gets you the PDF rules of the game. $28 gets you a full color hardcover edition of the game. For $40, you get a PDF, the hardcover edition of the rules, Gaia specialty dice, and biohazard luck tokens. So if you want the full experience, $40 is probably the way to go. And its estimated delivery date is June of this year. So you got 4 months to wait. But based on what we had talked about and how this is set up, it seems like a really, really cool, really interesting game. And probably well worth the investment. It's a kind of a spin on the zombie trope. Basically, these parasitic entities overtake human beings, and they could be either just mindless drones or a very small percentage of them actually gain psionic abilities. So there's a range between those two types of parasitic entities. Either they're incredibly mindless or they're incredibly mindful and psionic. So it seemed like a really cool take on that trope and this is done by the Polyhedral Knights, and they have created one other RPG, and it's called Spy. So they have successfully, yes, that was a successful campaign as well. So they have a track record of successfully delivering and creating games, and I think that this might be a good pick for people to add to their collection. Now, we are done talking about last week. Let's talk about this week. What do you got?
This week, because I'm in a very RPG in general mood, is how to write adventure modules that don't suck. This is from Goodman Games, who have published tons of adventures in tons of different settings for different game systems. I carry them in my store. Good stuff. And this one is, so it's a nice big book about basically how to basically write good adventures. And it's not just some dude who said, oh, I write amazing adventures, I'm going to write this book. This is a collaboration of, I forget how many are in here now, I read it, but a good dozen or more experienced people in the field who write, you know, this is what they, one of the things they do for a living. Oh yeah, here it is. I mean, you've got Joe Bittman, who's done Wizard of the Coast. He's worked for Levitating Flame Princess, Kobold Press. Mike Briault, who started back in 84 with TSR, going back to like Hero Quest from Milton Bradley and the Pool of Radiance computer RPG. Ann Brown, who used to be assistant editor of Dragon Magazine, Timothy Brown, also worked at TSR in Game Designers Workshop. Stephen Chenal, I'm probably pronouncing all these names wrong, even though I know who some of these people are. I mean, yeah, he's been writing RPGs for Trollord Games and Castles and Crusades and since 99. Casey Christofferson, who's been doing it for like 15 years. Chris Clark, Inner City and Fuzzy Hero, and Michael Curtis, who's been doing stuff forever. I mean, he's professionally, he's been playing forever. He's been professionally since 2008. Does a lot of stuff with Goodman Games. Dungeon Crawl Classics, which is also some great little mini adventures you can run. Joseph Goodman, owner of Goodman Games. Chris Doyle, Alan, I mean, just a ton of people. A ton of freaking people who, you know, this is what they do. They write adventures. Oh, Gene, I always pronounce her name wrong, Rabbi. She's been around for a while. Yeah, there's like 20 different people who are all in on this. they are looking for a whopping $5,000. There's still 9 days to go. They're currently at $53,000.
And all very close to a breakpoint for their next stretch goal, which is silk ribbons to be added to the hardcover. As of right now, you're going to get at the certain at the proper level, you'll get a hardcover print version. I just backed this while we were talking. I backed this at the $30 level, which there we go. It's the print backer. You'll receive a print and PDF version of how to write adventure modules that don't suck. Depending on stretch goals, this will either be hardcover or softcover. Well, as of this point, it is hardcover. So, boom.
Yeah, I mean, if you just want to do a basic, I mean, $12 gets you the PDF.
Yep.
$9, you can get their what is called their Adventures Almanac, which is a little basically adventure primer kit. Little adventure primers, treasures, stuff like that. $20 gets you the print version, or $19 gets you PDF of both books. $20 gets you the print version of the Adventures Almanac. $30, as Brad said, gets you the printed PDF of just lots of great ways to get in. And then, yeah, I mean, they've got stretch goals. And they've already, a lot of the stretch goals are just basically, it's making the product itself better.
Yeah.
As far as the book stuff goes, yeah.
And the only, at 80,000, they're going to print a collection of the favorite adventure essays for all the print backers.
Yeah.
So they're gonna add material to it, but they're essays that have already been written. So it's not going to be that difficult to put that together. So there you go. Yeah, with the pedigree of all the people that are attached to this product, you're gonna get your money's worth. Guaranteed. Yeah. Guaranteed. So uh, 160 pages, 25 authors. That's a whole lot of condensed awesome.
Yeah.
If you are interested in upping your game, creating adventures for your players that will rock their socks off and make them talk about it for years to come, this would probably be for you.
Yep. And you don't have to wait long either. Print book in June, as they say at the very bottom. It's all written already. Everything's written. Now it's just, it's layout and printing.
Yep. That is it. So that's awesome. Yeah. It's in the bag, and you know, I guess soft cover or hardcover will kind of determine some layout things. So this is definitely a guaranteed go. And you'll get some awesome material by the beginning of this summer. Or late spring, depending on what level you back at. But this is a great recommendation, and thank you for bringing that to our attention.
Absolutely.
And now we are going to talk about my current obsession. Which is watching YouTube videos of folks that paint miniatures, create terrain, and one of them is a company that actually makes this material, but they have some of the professionals on their team that work for the company that make materials for them for the purpose of photographing materials for diorama kits that they make. They have the professionals on their team make how-to videos with their material, which is really cool. The first one, I don't even know. You know, I know how I found it. I went to YouTube and I just typed in terrain. I think miniature terrain, I think, is what I typed in. And the first one that came up that seemed really interesting was, it's The YouTube channel is called Luke's APS, and that is Luke's Affordable Painting Service. Now, he is based in the UK, and he does a great job finding ways to help you build terrain on a budget, but have it still look good. And he will actually go through and, okay, for example, if you're going to build terrain with water features in it, okay, there are a number of different products. You could just do a resin. You could do a number of different things, and there are a number of different products. And what Luke's goal is, hang on a second, I have to sneeze. Sorry, I turned off the wrong microphone. I apologize. Still getting over the flu. he actually does comparisons of different products and shows you different ways that you can make water features. And he tries to be as economical as possible, but he will show you some of the higher end materials as well. And some of the solutions that he presents are kind of surprising and really, I don't want to say on the cheap, because it sounds like he makes subpar crap, and he doesn't. For the research and the things that he does, he tries to do the best that he can with keeping it at a low cost. Because you can buy some of the professional materials. He kind of runs counter to one of this recommendations that I'm going to make.
Sorry.
Sounds like you're mixing paint over there. anyway, and he does talk about mixing paint as well. Luke is, like I said, he's from the UK, and he is a very down-to-earth speaker, and he does a great job explaining the process that he goes through, and like I said, trying to keep things on the cheap to help you be as successful as you can possibly be, but not spend an arm and a leg to make terrain. And especially if you're just starting out, you might not have a whole lot of cash to spend to make something. So he makes a lot of great recommendations. Like some things, like for, for making some coarse shrubbery, like coarse grade shrubbery, he actually uses recycled foam, adds a bit, you know, kind of shreds it up a little bit, mixes in just a little bit of water, enough to get the foam damp, and then he puts it in a blender, like a bullet, like something for mixing smoothies, like a smaller kind of single-purpose blender. And the water helps give it enough weight so that it will chop it up. And he doesn't want to get it too fine, but he wants to get it, you know, chopped up just enough. And then he shows you, moving on from that point, how to mix the paint using a PVA glue, using a little bit of water, and getting it so it soaks through the foam completely. And he walks you through each of the steps, and it's really good, very instructive, and I highly recommend. It's called Luke's APS on YouTube. So check that out if you're interested. The next one that I'm going to recommend is former guest Adam Loper and his Tabletop Minions channel. Now, Adam is a very avid wargamer, working with Warhammer. And actually, that's the majority of his stuff that I've seen has been Warhammer. So he's got great tips for how to, you know, kind of get the best results for painting your miniatures. You've known Adam for a little bit. Yes?
Yes. Quite a while, actually, now. 5, 10 years.
Okay. And when we talked to Adam, it was mostly about running a convention, because he started one of the conventions in your neck of the woods.
Yes.
And but you know, his biggest passion is miniatures and miniature wargaming. Have you watched some of his videos on that?
The majority of them.
Okay. And what are some of the things that that you've liked about his videos? Some of the things that you've taken away.
First of all, Adam is very. He's a dry wit.
Yes. Yes, he is.
I love. I love that. I love dry wit. It's, you know, I mean, British comedy with the dryness of that I love, and that, and Adam has a very dry wit, and that is, it is not a shtick he's doing for his videos. That is Adam in general. I have sat with him and talked many times, and that's just Adam being Adam. And I like the very casual approach he takes to it, in that he gives you examples of how he does stuff. And he doesn't just talk about mini painting. He talks about all sorts of stuff. He's gone into things about where he did a whole thing on Age of Sigmar, and he's talked about, he said one where he talks about, hey, you know, if you play games at a game store, maybe buy something at that game store. And so he covers a lot of different topics, and it's his channel's done really, really well. I mean, he's got a lot of followers for something he's only been doing, I think, about 2 years now.
Yeah, it looks like he's got about a little over 40,000 subscribers.
Yeah. I mean, you know, this is, it's a niche market in a niche market. So, you know, it's a gaming podcast that is primarily about miniature gaming. But as I've learned listening to Adam and watching his videos and other ones, is that if you have good material, people will go just all in on these. And Adam actually jokes at times that a lot of his videos are too short, because a lot of people who are big minis painters, they want to listen to a podcast about minis painting while they're painting. So his, like, you know, 8-minute episodes aren't long enough. So he started doing some longer ones too, but it's just, he packs a good amount of information in a small thing, and he makes his videos enjoyable because it's not just him droning on about, and this is how you do dry brushing. He'll throw in little quips, little atomisms, as it were. So it makes it very enjoyable. It doesn't ever make it seem like it's so daunting, even though I'm a terrible minis painter and I don't take most of the advice he gives. It's more effort than I want to do. But I've done some of the things he recommends, and it, you know, it works out well.
Okay. Well, there you go. And I just started watching his videos, so I've only gotten a bit of that. And yes, from our interview and some of our pre-show talk, Adam seems to be a very no-nonsense kind of a person. Yes, he has a very dry, quick wit. And a good resource if you want to get into miniature painting. And he touches on obviously a lot more than that, but if you're looking for miniature painting advice, Adam's your guy. My third pick, and I mentioned that this kind of ran counter to Luke's affordable painting, it is Woodland Scenic. Woodland Scenics. Now, they make diorama and miniature materials for doing terrain work and things like that. Now, Woodland Scenics is really kind of been positioned more for like railroad miniature work and things like that. But obviously that can be easily moved over into doing work for miniature wargaming, or if you're just doing like tabletop RPG and you want to create some materials to better visualize the area in which you are playing. They have a lot of
I'm on their current main page for their YouTube channel. Mm-hmm. And just with the RPG, one of the things, it's for HO, but it's the Grand Gazebo. It's just perfect. Every RPG campaign needs a gazebo.
Absolutely. But Woodland Scenics makes a lot of different products for Model Railroad mostly, but they do make diorama kits for like school kids if they need to, you know, do a presentation on something. You can go to, I've gone to Michael's craft store and I've seen their prepackaged products for their diorama kits. So it is more than just Model Railroad stuff. Their HydroCal is it's a very fine, it's like plaster, but it's very, it's a lot more fine. And actually they use HydroCal for dentistry. Like if they want to make very good impressions and basically to make a set of your teeth and actually build off of it, they use HydroCal, which is a very, you know, a very fine plaster, I guess is, it's in that family. But they also make realistic water product, which is basically a resin that allows you to make water features. And I watched a whole presentation that they did on making waterfalls using some of this material. And it's absolutely fascinating. I spent a good, well, my lunches are an hour long. So I spent a better part of an hour watching some of just the water feature stuff and them going through not just making like a lake or a pond, but actually like an iced over pond, like a winter scene, and how they went through the process of adding paints and kind of layering the resin work. So it kind of got to look a little bit more like ice. They have all sorts of different flocking materials, not just materials for making trees, but they also make material for snow. They make materials for sand. They make representations of coal, obviously going back to the railroad portion of of their product line. They have all sorts of materials that can represent all sorts of different things. So if you want to make terrain for fantasy, for urban fantasy, for, you know, cyberpunk, whatever, you have the ability to use these different products, and they show you different ways to utilize them and get the most out of them to do whatever it is you're looking to do. And the nice thing, you know, every one of these that I'm recommending to you have playlists. So if there's something specifically that you're looking for, like just stuff on doing, like in this particular case for Woodland Scenics, if you're looking for a playlist on just doing features like icicles or trying to make rocks look wet. What's another playlist that they have? They make a tool just for cleaning up railroad tracks and rails. So if you are doing, if you've laid your track and you're doing scenery work around the track, they have a tool that they've specifically made for you to run over the track and like clean everything off to ensure that your train doesn't hit like maybe a bit of like water feature material that might have spilled on it, and it's clear and hard to see. And you know, you don't want to derail an expensive train and possibly wreck your scenery as well. So they have all sorts of playlists and great how-to videos on how to use their products. So while this is not a paid, recommendation, it was nice to see them do kind of full service to show you the best ways to use their products and not just, hey, we sell stuff, here you go. Here's, you know, they actually walk you through it, which is I really kind of dug.
I use some of their stuff too, particularly a lot of their flocking and their trees and stuff like that.
Yeah, and the reason why I said it kind of runs counter to like Luke's APS, Luke's Affordable Painting Service, is while he extols the virtues of Woodland Scenics, he doesn't appreciate the price tag.
Yeah.
Which is understandable. And like when he was in some of his videos, he talks about when he first started out, he didn't really have the money to pay for some, like a small bag of flock can be, you know, and he, of course this is in British pounds, but you know, it's like three and a half pounds for like a 3 ounce bag of flock, which is really expensive. And, you know, he's talking about spending like 6 pounds, maybe a little over 6 to 7 pounds. That gets you the paint, the PVA glue, recycled foam. And he's making 10 quarts of flock. So, I mean, it's a radical savings, and what he's recommending will, you know, obviously stretch your dollar that much further. Again, he's not knocking Woodland Scenics. He's just trying to do things on a budget. And his whole business model is Warhammer gamers that don't have the time to make terrain can hire him to make terrain for them. So, again, he's just looking at his bottom line and trying to make things good quality, but less expensive and less to his bottom line, so he can make a little bit more of a profit, but still be in a good price range where people will buy his work. So the last recommendation I'm going to make is Dr. Faust's painting clinic. Now, great information. I watched a video that he did for making a good quality looking base that was like kind of scorched and cracked earth, and then attaching a miniature to it. His shtick, though, is using an accent, which sounds kind of steampunky, and that seems to kind of be his shtick. Steampunky is the only way I can explain it. It sounds posh and British, but there seems to be bits of older vernacular that he throws in there. And I get that you want to be a little bit different. I mean, there's a lot of people, you know, you could do a search and find all sorts of people that do terrain and painting stuff like that. So you want to be unique. And I get that. And like I said, the information that he imparts is amazing. His painting skill is absolutely amazing. The work that he does, you know, and he's painting, like, here we go, Blood Bowl Orcs. The game Blood Bowl. God, I remember playing that in the 90s. Basically, it's like football to the extreme, except you've got orcs, you've got... When I played, it was with just a group of orcs, but I think that are there other opponents that you can play in Blood Bowl? Or is it just orcs?
Oh, there's lots of guys you can play in Blood Bowl.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
You've got orcs, you've got dwarves, you've got elves. I think you have werewolves, you've got, I think there's undead. Tons of them.
Yeah, the last time I played was like 1991, maybe 1990. So
it's been a while.
It's been a while. I definitely remember the orcs. I remember that my friend Jeff had not painted painted them all yet. So they were, I believe that the plastic was blue. So yeah, these blue orcs you're playing with. But if you go to his YouTube page, he's got a 1/8 scale penguin, which is the Burgess Meredith version of the like 1960s Batman. And he paints that. And the paint job he does, the face looks lifelike. It really does look like Burgess Meredith. His work is absolutely incredible. But like I said, the presentation with what he does with his voice, I had to kind of filter out a little bit and try to focus more on the content than the delivery. But the wisdom that he has to impart is top notch. And he's, if you want to learn to do something from the best, Dr. Faust's Painting Clinic is definitely a place to go if you want to get really great skills to paint miniatures at a very professional level. I highly recommend it. And actually, he's sitting at a little over 53,000 subscribers. So other people don't have the same problem that I do with his presentation. But the knowledge he imparts is, like I said, top notch. So those are my four recommendations. Like I said, the YouTube is filthy with different people that have advice, recommendations, and tips, tricks, hints on how to paint miniatures. But those are the four that I've really stumbled across and have been watching lately. And I highly, highly recommend. So is there anybody else that you can think of, Glenn? I know you paint miniatures, but you don't necessarily enjoy it. But is there anybody that you go, oh, you know, when I was first starting out, I watched X.
And there's someone else who does some interesting little tutorials for some terrain is Terrainaholic. I don't know if he's updated much recently, but I see him at some of the local cons around here.
Okay.
I bought some of his stuff. And the big one is for those who really want to get into some heavy-duty terrain making, it's Hirst Arts.
Oh, God, yes.
You get the molds, and you actually cast all your own bricks when you build your own stuff. Dr. Randy Wolfmeyer.
Yes. Previous guest.
Is very good at some of the stuff. He is mill-making lately, but, I mean, his castle still is a glorious thing.
Oh, God, it's mind-numbingly awesome. Yeah. And if you go back and look at, oh gosh, was he episode 4? I mean, he was very early on. I want to say that he was episode 4. And we have pictures of his castle and some of his other terrain work, and it is mind-numbingly awesome.
Now, the thing I will say with Hirst Arts is that, one, it is not cheap.
No, it is not.
The average mold is about $30. You can do a lot with two or three molds.
Yes.
I think Randy probably made his castle with, I'm guessing, between the probably 3 to 5 different molds. It might have been a little bit more if you throw like the roof and stuff like that, but then the plaster is it best self uses dental plaster.
Yep, which is hydrocal.
Yep, pretty much. Usually a lot of times you can buy them direct from some people, and you can get about $50 for 50 pounds. Plus the shipping, which is not cheap for 50 pounds of something.
No.
But it's labor intensive, but you get some great looking stuff. Because, you know, you're casting 15 blocks at a time, and I guess you're going to use a couple thousand. So,
yeah. I remember Randy saying he just, you know, he'd mix up his hydrocal, slather it in the mold, and let it sit, and just he kept going.
And not forget about it, because you pour it in, you let it sit for maybe 5-10 minutes, and you have to go scrape the top of the mold off.
Yes.
And if you forget that, then you just wasted a bunch of your plaster.
Yeah. Yeah. But Randy's kind of a details guy, so that was definitely probably not an issue for him. So. All right. So there you have it. We've got Luke's APS, Luke's Affordable Painting Service, Tabletop Minions, Woodland Scenics, and Dr. Faust's Painting Clinic. And we've got Terrainaholic and Hirst Arts as our recommendations for YouTube channels that you should check out if you're interested in miniature painting and terrain building. Now, we are going to move on to feedback here. And I promised you that we got a call from they went to our website, and we have a link where you can actually, if you have a microphone attached, or no, I take that back. His was actually a phone call in. We have an interesting setup. It uses relatively the same system. If you call the number, It goes to Google Voice and it records the call. And then what ends up happening is Dave Nelson, who is our CEO, the creator of Galactic Networks, he forwards that on to me. And we got a call from a gentleman by the name of Boto Winter, and here it is.
Hey, calling about the Adventure Party. Have you ever watched Harmon Quest on CISO? You would enjoy it. My name is Boto Winter. Anyway, enjoy the show. Have a great day. Bye. Hey, calling about...
Hey, hang on. I hit it twice. I like the call so much, I thought I'd play it again. No, thank you, Boto Winter, for calling in. And I've heard of Harmon Quest. I'm just really bad about spending money for online services to watch things. And CISO has a lot of different things, but it wasn't enough to pique my interest to jump into it, to get into Harmon Quest. Now, I don't know, maybe Glenn, you're in a different spot.
Let's quest. I have seen the whole first season.
Okay.
Thanks to a friend of mine who has no problem forking out money for everything ever made, ever.
So I do enjoy Dan Harmon's work. Loved Community. Love Rick and Morty. And he's, you know, he's had his hand in a few other projects too. But I couldn't see to part with the money to get on board with CISO. So,
understandable.
But Glenn, you've watched it. What are your thoughts?
I love it. It's fun. I mean, it's much more comedic approach. I mean, he has a special guest every week. He's had Aubrey Plaza's been on there. Nathan Fillion was on an episode. And I'm blanking on everybody else. I think John Hodgman was on an episode. Yes. So, I mean, you know, he pulls out, you know, all the people he knows, you know, because of what he does now, and he gets them all on his show. It's pretty darn funny.
So, yeah, I mean, I've heard great things about it. But yeah, like I said, I have not seen it. Glenn has. Glenn enjoys it a great deal. And based on that recommendation, I would look into paying for CISO at least long enough to watch Harmon Quest. So based on your recommendation and Glenn's recommendation, I might give it a shot. So thank you very much for calling in and talking with us, Boto. And we got one more bit of feedback from a gentleman named Scott Schwartz.
Oh, that guy.
What does that mean?
He's actually a friend.
Oh, okay.
I'm assuming it's the same Scott Schwartz. So it's another local Milwaukee guy. We've done some game design and actually worked at my store for a holiday season. So,
okay. I'm looking at his channel. It is McLaird One. If you're going
that
to look,
be, that up. Would definitely be him.
Okay. Okay. So Scott, thank you for contacting us. And Scott mentioned, and this is based on last week's episode where we talked about Elite Dangerous. We talked about the Elite series of games. And Scott mentions Elite Dangerous is also an excellent online real-time space sim worth checking out. So I think I might expand my horizons and give Elite Dangerous a shot and check into it. So thank you very much for that recommendation, Scott. I appreciate that. Well, if you would like to be like Boto Winter or Scott Schwartz, you could contact us in a number of different ways. You could join our Slack chat, which if you go to gncasts.com/signup, you can be added to our Slack team. What is Slack, Brad? That's a good question. I'm glad you asked that. Slack is it was really designed for development teams, I think, originally, people that work on software and work in different offices, and they can remotely connect and chat with each other and talk about the projects that they're working on. It was opened up. We use it where I work, where all of the web designers can all talk with each other in the different offices that they're in, and you know, toss ideas back and forth or ask each other specific questions or whatnot. We use it so that we can talk with you, the listener. We also talk with each other. We have an open channel where everybody that signs up can chit-chat with us. We also have a private channel for where the different hosts talk with each other to share promo audio or different things like that. So it's a wonderful tool. We enjoy it, and you could be a part of it. All you need to do is go to gncasts.com/signup, and you can be a part of our Slack team. Now, you can also contact us by, like Boto Winter did, by leaving a voicemail message by calling 805-328-3966. Again, 805-328-3966. You can go to gncasts.com/contact, where you can contact us in a number of different ways. We also have a link where you can, if you have a microphone attached to your computer, you can click that and you can leave a voice message directly with us without having to make a phone call. You can subscribe to this Galactic Network podcast by going to gncasts.com/subscribe, or you can search us out on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play Music, or anywhere podcasts are offered. You can also get our show notes and check out our audio versions of the podcasts by going to gncasts.com/adventure. So, Glenn, I want to thank you very much for taking the time to chit-chat with me about terrain, about 10 candles, which knocked my socks off. And where can people find out more about you and what you do?
And about finished bread foams now. See ya, Kupata. In other words, yours, Brad. You can find out more about me on Facebook with the B-Movie Bunker and Guy in a Bunker Productions, Mr. of the RPG. Follow me on Twitter at Guy in a Bunker. Check out guyinabunker.com or mr.com. Check out some of the other podcasts I do, which is Astro Radio Z, The Spoiler Room. Occasionally, I am on the Film Jerks. I do a lot of stuff when I should be doing other stuff. You can also check me out if you're in Milwaukee. Stop in at the Board Game Barrister. I am transitioning to a new store that I'm opening up out at Mayfair Mall, which is going to be sucking up a lot of my time the next few months getting that up and running. So I'm a busy, busy boy.
So bigger space to work with?
Smaller. But, well, kind of smaller, a smaller play space, but it's should be a pretty busy store. Mayfair is a really busy mall.
Okay, cool. Very cool. So moving out of Glendale and into Mayfair.
Yes. 4 minutes closer to my house. Yes. Yes.
Nice. There you go. What more could you ask for? Say, I want to thank everybody for joining us here on the Adventure Party. May your characters never die and your adventures always be epic. Thank you and good night.